And to start the session, I would like to have the chairperson on the stage. First, I would like to call Dr. Nirbhay Srivastava, sir. Nirbhay sir has been Dean Medical College Bhopal and he has been the DME also. Sir. To accompany him, I invite Dr. Jitendra Jamdar, sir. Jamdar, sir, has been the past president of MPIU. Dr. Manish Jha is not present, I think.
Good morning, everybody. We've got the first session, whereas we have interesting subjects, evolution of fixation, for fracture of lower and radius, distal radial, metaphyseal and physial fractures. So we'll have Dr. Vikas Gupta on the dais first.
Just to introduce our learned speaker, Dr. Vikas Gupta. He was associated with AIIMS New Delhi for about 20 years, and he has done a hand senior fellowships at Mayo Clinic, USA and Germany. He is at present head of the Department of Shoulder and Hand at Max Saket. We welcome Vikas for your presentation. Thank you.
Distal radius fracture, one of the commonest fractures. Everyone has dealt with it for ages since like your residency, you're dealing with it. And most of the time, we are giving good results. But it depends. Are we looking at long-term results or immediate results? And things have changed. Epidemiology of distal radius fractures have changed. Demands of patients have changed. Options have become enormous. So we'll be discussing what are the options, how it has evolved distal radius. So nothing to disclose much. Only thing, I have been consulted with the Smith and Nephew and the Zimmer. We developed a polyaxial plate, but no financial benefit for this talk. So distal radius fracture, it goes like Colles fracture, Abraham Colles, more than 200 years ago, before X-rays were discovered. He described this fracture and he said in the end that whatever you do, patient will be pain-free, have good movements with slight deformity throughout the life. But now things have changed because we have now high energy trauma, young patients are with us. It's not the Colles fracture, 60, 70-year-old osteoporotic women having a fall, having a distal radius fracture. Majority of our fractures are good. Amount of our fractures are young people with RTA, with intra-articular fractures, with intra-articular comminuted fractures, with combination of other injuries are there. So there are stable fractures and unstable fractures. I won't be going in detail, but whenever fracture is unstable, we have to do something. Either we do percutaneous pinning, just do a closed reduction, give a good traction and manipulate the fracture. Reduction is many times easy and you just fix it, give a cast. External fixation is another modality because in 90s it was very popular. At that time we didn't have much options, plates were not holding and they were failing, failure of plates were very high and collapse was very common. So fixator was a good choice, it worked on a principle of ligamentotaxis. But if we look at ligaments of the wrist, it is volar ligament which are stout and dorsal ligaments which are zigzag and they are lax. So whenever you give a traction, it is very difficult to correct the dorsal tilt. By fixators alone, it is difficult to control, to reduce intra-articular fracture. Radial length is many times you achieve a good radial length, but with the tissues becoming lax and tension becoming lesser, it collapses. And we cannot take care of depressed lunate fragment. Just an example for distal radius, this was a compound fracture, debrided, external fixator given, fixed with wires, long-term result, reasonably good results. So it's not that it doesn't give good result, but in selected cases, it is very effective. What about plates? Plates started with buttress plate. For a long time, almost 3 or 4 decades, we had Alice plate, which was key for distal radius fracture. Then came small plates, fragment specific fixation, which were specifically for the small fragments, volar, dorsal and radial plates. Then came locking plates. When locking plates came into existence, then things have changed. We'll be seeing that. Buttress plate, the thing was, it was only for the buttressing of the fracture. So we were not catching hold of the comminuted fracture. If there's a comminution, there would be collapse. We could not prevent collapse with the buttress plate because there was no angle fixation screws. And it was not a low profile, so tendon irritation was high. So 90s it was there, but major indication for these plates were Wohler-Barton fractures. But if you put it for comminuted fractures, this was one of the cases in 1998. We put a plate, fracture collapse such that it became angulated as well as plate started irritating the fragments. So at that time, we started doing a dual plating. So locking plates were not there. So only thing we could do buttress. So we started buttressing from dorsum and volar. For the again Wohler-Barton fracture, if steloid is comminuted, wire was not good enough to hold the steloid fragment, so radial height was lost. To overcome this, first get a buttress on the volar side. Can I point? Then you get a buttress on the radial aspect to get the radial length. So two incisions was a common thing at that time. Because radial artery used to pass and there was no undermining of the skin, so wound healing was never a problem in such cases. So many cases in that era we used to do radial plating, volar plating, some interfragmentary fixation. Then in 2004, first time 3.5 locking plates came into India. That was the time when we started doing, and that was the time started addressing fractures like this with open reduction. Because before that, you used to think whenever you open, results are not going to be good. So fix these fractures, get a reasonably good results. So even if there's a communication or something like void like this, we stopped doing bone grafting because our screws were holding the distal fragment. This is just an intra-op video which shows that even with the gap, the screws are holding. So you could mobilize them early. Then again, 2004-05, internationally, this I was doing my fellowship, Howard. So this system was launched, 2.4. Advantage was that there were multiple screws, locking screws in the distal fragment. So you could get a better hold in the distal fragment, even if there's a gap or something like that. So these plates were launched in India for first time in 2007. And fixation, we started doing fixation with these and started mobilizing them early to get good results. So this is how it evolved. So you don't have to immobilize them. If you have to immobilize them, DRG thing, if there's a DRG injury or other things, otherwise for distal radius fracture, you could mobilize them early. Even for compound fractures, started using these plates. So this was a plate in which could go really distally, just proximal to watershed area. All the screws would go proximally, 5 degrees proximal away from the joint, so they would not penetrate into the joint. At the same time, different companies brought the same principle, different designs. So then the India DVR was launched. DVR was launched by Zimmer, but it was already available in India in 2007. How DVR was different than other plates, because there were two rows of screws in the distal fragment. And both of these rows would go and they would intersect each other within the bone to give a better stability. So this was patented, so no other implant could get this design. So what happened? If you're going too distally, either you're irritating flexor tendon or the chances that you are going into the joint, something like this. So with fractures which are distal volar lift fractures, they were very difficult to be treated with this. So then came again 2010 came this implant. This was a variable angle locking plate in which you could put a lock screw with a 15 degree of radius. So it was a cone of 30 degrees In each direction, you can change the screw direction and still lock it. So this was something like this. Then this was one of our cases. When you look at this X-ray, it gives the trouble. That was the time when we started thinking radiographs, proper radiographs are important, because many times this would be a cause of concern. But if you get a proper radiograph, you can see all the screws are within the joint. If we just same, it's same patient, just a change in the view. The proximal part is a volar cortex because there's a volar tilt. Distal part is a dorsal cortex. So any screw which is not in this area is not into the joint. Why we have to go so distally? Why you have to go very distally to get the near the joint and increase our anxiety? This was a biomechanics paper in which says subchondral placement gives the best stability. So your best bone is subchondral. If you want a hold in the screws, it has to be subchondral. So there's not a very big margin. So you have to have a purchase in the bone as well as not getting into the joint. So accuracy has to be there. With variable angle, you can change that and according to the patient, according to the fracture. Then 2012, another plate came, which was for the very distal fracture. It just goes up to the margin. It is the only plate which crosses your watershed area. This is your watershed area. This plate crosses the watershed area. This is for, it's not a better plate or something. It has very few indications. Indications like when there's a volar lip fracture or fractures are two distal fractures like this intra-articular fractures which are distal, which are not amenable to fixation by the normal plate, can be taken care by this plate. So we'll be seeing example in one of our talks for distal radius. So fractures which are very distal can be tackled with this plate. This was a project which we finished in 2013. I was there from India, but few surgeons decided and designed this plate, which has two rows of variable angle fragment. Unfortunately, it's not marketed in India, so we won't be seeing that. So in a conclusion, I would say that locking plate, they're giving a very consistent results. There were like last year 24 papers reported good to excellent results for the distal radius fracture, which were fixed with ORIF or fixed with locking plates. And from design point of view, I think we have reached a plateau. We are not seeing anything different coming in last one decade, which is very game changer. So what we'll be seeing in design from the distal radius would be more on a biomaterials rather than design. These are the few things we can suggest reading. I would like to end with this. Distal radius fracture treatment, what you get may depend on your age and address. This was very famous article for the distal radius like 2009, and it was for the US. So it's not that one is better than other. It's the many times the choice of the surgeon, experience of the surgeon choosing a treatment. Thank you.